This is the story of one community's battle against the Mississippi River in the summer of 1993. Two sets of levees protect the area. The first efforts were concentrated on the levees along the Mississippi. Preparing for the flood, the gates were closed on the highway. Sandbags were stacked in the town, ready for use. Trying to take it as we go. It'll be bumpy, but at least it'll show some things. On the inside of the levees, there was a great deal of seep water throughout the bottoms. The farms had been evacuated and all machinery, animals, and household goods removed. The artifacts had been removed from Fort Deschartres. On July 25th, the Corps withdrew from efforts to save the levee beyond Fort Deschartres. Expecting that this levee would break, the final 50-foot gap in the Prairie du Rocher Creek levee was filled in, removing the Union Pacific railroad tracks. That night, the farmers went back out to Fort Deschartres and raised a sandbag levee to contain the boils. A sand boil occurs when pressure from the river forces water through the soil under the levee. It erupts in a bubbling mixture of soil and water.
Well, let's just try to get it draped around there, and I'll see if I can't hold it down in there.
You want to leave?
I need dirt water. Mark, about leave, Chief?
About right up there. If I get this wet, I'll be fired.
You can just hold it, get it to start holding some material.
Comes another truck.
Barrels with both ends cut out are placed over the boils so that a water column builds up and the pressure stops the boil. If not stopped, the boil can create a tunnel and cause part of the levee to collapse.
We're right here at the mouth of the creek right now in the corner.
Okay, because we're going to have to send a truck down to towards Lock and Dam with sandbags. It's going to be there by 9 o'clock.
Well, I'll drive it.
Okay, do you have some people to go with that?
The coal miners over in Ellis Grove are going to be there waiting.
At this location, there were so many boils that the Corps built a gravel ring levee. Water was then pumped into the area to equalize the pressure. A local pilot flew the levees daily to spot boils, as vegetation made it difficult to see them from the ground. On our way out to the fort and another area near the fort, which also had numerous boils. Barrels and a section of grain bin had been placed here to contain the boils, but a larger containment was needed. A barge with a drag line was brought in, and a barge with gravel was maneuvered between the levee and the trees. Thank you. Gravel was put on the side of the levee and pushed out by machinery. To speed the building, the other half of the levee was constructed first of sandbags. Then it was pumped full of water. In another area of Boyle's, a new method was being tried, an inflatable dam, a huge plastic tube with double tubes inside it. It was pulled out to the location. Water was pumped into it and it acted as a dike. Very early in the morning on August 2nd, the Mississippi levee upriver at Fountain Creek was overtopped. The flooding of the area outside the creek levees was now inevitable. Efforts were redoubled to hold the Trestle levee and the north levee of Great Erosha Creek, which protects the town and the bottoms as far as Chester. Trucks haul stone to raise the height of the levee from 50 to 52 feet. Because Prairie du Rocher is 11 feet lower than where the break was, there was concern about the force of the water coming down. Coast Guard divers opened the gates to 2 6-foot tubes that run through the levee, releasing water from the river into the interior of the Mississippi levee to slow the approaching waters. Also, a 400-foot long breach was cut to allow water to flow in and slow the oncoming flood, and then to allow an exit for the waters. With the break at Fountain Creek, flooding was inevitable, and now the concern was to hold the Prairie du Rocher levees. It took over 24 hours before the water reached Prairie du Rocher. There was a desperate but doomed effort to save one of the homes closest to the bluff.
Thank you.
some places.
Volunteers worked on the levee until 7:30 p.m., when they were called off because of the danger. The water level was rising 6 inches an hour. Although the river was now lower than the water on the interior, the water was not flowing out the cut fast enough and was continuing to fill up the area. At 9:30, when there was only 1 foot of freeboard on the levee, a small group went back out and sandbagged through the night, until 4 a.m., when a section of the Mississippi levee was dynamited. That section did not provide sufficient space to get the water out quickly enough, so at 5 a.m., another area was dynamited. In the morning, the National Guard continued carrying bags, as had been done the night before, but a call for sandbaggers produced a long, long line of 1,000 people.
About 4:30. I measured it. Oh, at least 3 hours.
You have
one.
Coast Guard's got boats in Sparta. I passed them on the way in. I'll see if I can get some in that way.
Rank and I'll
go in there.
And ask him if he can bring his boat down.
Just get your point. I'll see if we get the Coast Guard.
I contacted there.
Hey, Mark.
Coast Guard
booked down.
We're going to try again.
At the other end of the levee, the Mississippi was pouring over the levee in an area which could only be reached by boat, and a flotilla of boats was volunteered.
You get all them film
sometime. I'd like to see him, Mark.
Yeah, well, that's, I just hope it ends up as a happy ending, at least for some. As the river reached 54 feet on the sandbagged creek levees, there were problems with boils again, and a new gravel dike had to be built. Flights over the levees continued. Water from the interior began to pour out into the river, which was at a lower level. Homes in the community outside the creek levees were inundated. Bottomlands were now a vast inland sea. Thank you. Fort de Chartres, the water was up to the sentry boxes on the walls.
Powder magazine.
The river topped a low place in the levee by the fort and cut it. Before the cut. After. The town was surrounded by water. Water began to recede, flowing out the cuts faster than it was coming in upstream.
Anything about any piling. So I don't know. I guess it's wishful thinking.
The homes outside the levee began to reappear from the water. And the bridge. Along the road to the fort is one of the breaks blown in the levee. The cut. This is the area shown earlier where the tubes under the levee were opened along the road. The water is rushing out with great force and cutting the ground beneath it. The water level has dropped sufficiently so that the trestle levee has been reopened and trains can begin to run again. At long last, the gates are reopened. But the road is still covered in places, and the water is rushing over it by the cut. A tremendous cleanup job is left. The inflatable dikes served their purpose, but were overwhelmed from upriver. Although the river has gone down, homes outside the creek levee were badly damaged from weeks of immersion, and the work of cleaning up is just starting. The fort itself suffered little damage. The stone walls remain unharmed. The huge cannon platforms floated up and later settled by the powder magazine. But the cut created great damage to the grounds.
Sticking out of one of those cannon ports over there.
The cannon.
Oh, it is a cannon then?
Yes, that's one of those little jobs we're going to have to do eventually, is to figure out how we get the cannon out of there.
How on earth did it get there?
The cannon platform, which has disappeared, floated up, deposited the cannon, muzzle down, fortunately.
And then floated away.
And then floated away. Although part of the community outside the levees was lost, the town survived. Prairie de Rocher won the battle to hold the levees.